Hachette Audio presents A Calling for Charlie Barnes. Written by Joshua Ferris. Read by Nick Offerman. This book is dedicated to Woody Cram, drinker of martinis, and Brendan Kennedy, more of a beer man. Models of honor in a world full of men. I'd like to thank my brother, Brian, for standing by me when we were growing up and while I wrote this. I'm also grateful to my mother for believing in art and truth and for supporting the idea of the book. To my brilliant and talented older sister, Lori, for coming around to it, and to my younger sister, Maureen, whom I will always love. Jeanette Walls, from the acknowledgments page of The Glass Castle. Farce, or 105 Rust Road. A strictly factual account of the day of his diagnosis. 1. Steady boy woke, showered and spritzed, skipped breakfast for the time being and headed into work. Oh, what a glorious morning. Maybe. The weather in the basement was unknown. The computer required waking, made its little nibbling noises when stirred from its slumber, said its staticky hellos. The old office chair, the cold basement damp. Steady Boy had a desk calendar from 1991, a letter opener in the fashion of a gem-encrusted rapier, a ratty-ass Rolodex, and at his feet a rug. The rug, however, made moving around in the roller chair a living hell. So a sheet, listen to this, this is a true story, a sheet of stamped plastic specifically designed to facilitate the easy rolling of roller chairs in challenging terrain was purchased from Office Depot some years back by Steady Boy. Steady Boy? No one had called him that in 30, 40 years. Back then, Charlie Barnes had found it hard to keep a job. Either because the pay was bad, or the boss was a dick, or the work itself was a pain in the ass. And someone, an uncle probably, dubbed him Steady Boy, and the name stuck the way Tiny will stick to a big fat man. Steady Boy's knocking off early again. Steady Boy's calling in sick. That sort of thing. The paying gig that another man considered manna from heaven was, for Steady Boy, an encroachment on private land. He valued his freedom. He enjoyed his sleep. He liked to read the funny pages at his leisure. So much for all that. Steady Boy was Mr. Charles A. Barnes now, 68 years old that morning, a small businessman and father of four. And likely to live forever. 2. Ah, but it was all pretense and fakery. He was a big fat fraud. Shouldn't think like that, but it was true. God damn it was, certainly where his teeth were concerned. Other areas too, his achievements, his framed certificates, big deal. He hadn't even finished college. Hang that up on your wall, Steady Boy. Failure number one, as far as he was concerned, no college degree. Failure number two, all the times he lied about having a college degree. Failure number three, screw this. Failure number three was his reluctance to look back for too long. He was too proud and too pressed for time to be reviewing all his damn failures. We'd be here all year. Steady Boy didn't have a year. Steady Boy had cancer, that's what he had. But hey, not just any cancer, the big kahuna of cancers, pancreatic. Heard about that one? Cancer of the pancreas is the piano that falls from the sky. You have time to glance up, maybe, then splat, like a bug on the cosmic grill. His achievements, ha! He'd spent half his life prepping the next big thing. It never panned out. Steady Boy did not, in fact, have a hard time holding down a job. He just never wanted to be a sucker, a schlub, or a mid-level this or that. Like anyone, he had hoped to make a killing, become a household name, live forever. Well, he would not now. That was just a done deal. We really need to stop calling him Steady Boy. Good God, he thought first thing as he took a seat at his desk, the failures. All the marketing materials he still had somewhere, still shrink-wrapped, bales of the stuff. Beautiful four-color trifold brochures in service to nothing now. Nothing. His sunk costs alone could bury him alive. In pursuit of the American dream, Steady Boy had spent a small fortune on promotional ballpoints. He'd branded water bottles, keychains, stress balls. Bold Charlie Barnes would have branded his own ass with a red-hot poker to give his ideas a better shot in the marketplace. But what happened every time? Nothing happened. Without so much as a whimper, they just withered and died. 3. What do you want from me, huh? What did you expect? Those were some of the questions Steady Boy was asking that morning, after waking his computer and sitting a while with the rapier-style letter opener, contemplatively cleaning his nails. But of whom was he asking them? His children? Ex-wives? Old colleagues, maybe, like that bastard Larry Stovall. He knew Larry from his time at Bear Stearns, that scrappy brokerage firm with the dog-eat-dog mindset now kaput. He and Larry Stovall were good buddies back then. This was years ago. Charlie worked the retail desk while Larry cleared dubious trades at the direct orders of Jimmy Kane, Bear's CEO, doing God knows what damage to the moral universe. But what was it that kept Larry up at night? It wasn't boiler rooms and FTC fines. It was Charlie's affair with a nurse at First Baptist. It was fall 1992. The nurse's name was Barbara. Larry didn't like her. Didn't like the idea of her. Larry, the Oak Brook deacon, didn't give a damn about Wall Street thievery, but coveting thy neighbor's wife? Now that Larry could not abide. Human hypocrisy of this magnitude was one reason Charlie always felt far from God. Little did Larry know that that guilt-ridden affair, which ended when Charlie left Evangeline and married the nurse, sent him, for the first and only time in his life, to a therapist's couch just to pull himself together. Honestly, he'd assumed the extramarital shame would go on eating him alive, like the guy who stole fire from the gods and had his liver picked clean by birds. But did Larry offer him any comfort? Take-home pay that put Larry Stovall in the halls of Valhalla, but he still couldn't afford a little compassion for his fellow fallen man. Larry, Charlie had said, making himself vulnerable to his good old friend, I'm in real trouble here. And what did the guy do? Treated him like a fucking pariah. He set down the letter opener, picked up the phone, and dialed.
Wells Fargo, Larry Stovall's office.
So, Charlie said, Larry works for Wells now, does he? Charlie was in the roller chair on top of the slip mat that lay on top of the rug, the cordless at his ear. It had been over 15 years since he had last spoken to Larry Stovall.
He sure does, the woman said.
He was at Washington Mutual before Wells, Charlie said, and UBS before WAMU. When the woman said nothing, he added, As you can tell, I like to keep an eye on his career.
I can see that, the woman said, but unfortunately Larry hasn't quite made it into the office this morning. Can I leave a message for you?
Sure, he said. This is Charlie Barnes calling. I'm an old colleague from Bear Stearns. Can you tell Larry that I have pancreatic cancer, please?
The receptionist went silent.
"That's Charlie Barnes," he said. "Old colleague. Pancreatic cancer. Thank you."
He hung up. 4. The events currently being narrated unfolded in the fall of 2008, at the start, hard as it was to believe at the time, of an era of hope and change. There was a sudden massive liquidity freeze. The banks were crumbling, the feds were scrambling, the Great Recession was on its way. It was a golden era, believe it or not, yet things were bad. People were losing their homes, their livelihoods, their nest eggs. Government bailouts followed the corporate bleeding. The asylum, meanwhile, by which Charlie meant banking institutions, state governments, the White House, had been overtaken some time back by the inmates themselves, a slate of elected officials and their functionaries that was, to a man, entirely fucking corrupt. The reckoning at Bear Stearns had come 6 months earlier.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.